So, hello and welcome in this last video in the section of making decisions. And I know this section was a really, really short one, but there's not really much more to it that I could tell you right now. However, the last tool that we learn is really helpful when it comes to handling multiple outcomes. So what I mean by that is, maybe just have a look at the code I have here. We give a random here, that's our method, we call it inside our string, and just to make it short, this dollar sign here means that inside our string we can have code executed. Maybe to sum it up quickly, and this code is standing in between these curly brackets. So the code give random with the parameters 0 and 4 gets executed, and then returned over here, and then just put into the string. Maybe to call it like that. And give random, we talk about how that works, what this is when we come to the object-oriented part. But basically you just provide a minimum value and a maximum value and then just get a random number in this range. And we return it here. So you can see, all we do is essentially giving back an int that has like random, or it's random. So if we test this multiple times, there should be different numbers, but yes, it's not that many, and I think that randomness in computer science often is biased, so it's not really random, but that's another topic. So what I wanted to now is have different events executed for different outcomes. So what we could do is tell our program, or write our program if, and just go ahead here and change the comments here. If our buffer equals 0, we would do this. And else, if our buffer equals something else, we would say this. And I think that you all know how this works by now, but if really is used most of the times when you have binary outcome. So if you expect it to be 0 or not 0, but if you have different event planned, different events planned like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, it's not the best way to go. And you could do it, but especially as the lines get longer and as you have more values, you will do something else. An example that I can think of right now is when you get input, key input, you will test for different keys. W, S, A, D, F, and it would not be a good way to have all these linked with else's and ifs. So, as you may have seen in the title of the subscript, the thing that we use is a switch. And again, same structure, we have the brackets here, round brackets, and then the curly brackets here. And I think, or I feel like it's really bad that they don't tell you what it's to put in here, but basically you put in a variable in here. I don't know, it's not really a variable what we have to put in here, but it is the thing that you expect to have a different outcome. Maybe to put it like this, but I think it will become more clear, or clearer when we once we apply it, really. Sorry for that. So we put our buffer here. So our buffer is what we just put it blankly here, what we want to perform our else ifs on. So it's not else ifs, but you would do it on buffer. So you would say if buffer equals 0 and in all the other cases, and the same variable comes into here, just variable, no condition. And I said different cases, but this is really what's going to be about. So you can say case and then make a double point here, and then you would write out your code here. You see that it's underlined, and you just want to type in here what you expect, and our first case is 0 here. And the fallout, it's something that we wanna discuss later. For now, we just type in break. And now, see, that is something that you would do. If it's longer, it makes sense to put it in scope. But I think just for this video, it's not important. So just to type it in quickly, we could have a case 0. One. Just for example here. And then again, it cannot fall out, so break. And you can add all your cases, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. The last thing that you want to do, just to make it like just convention, I think, or I guess. But what you will see is a default behavior. And now we just come to the structure here. So here you provide the number that you want to have fallen through the switch. So you can really imagine that it falls through here. And you test, is this case 0? So is buffer equal to 0? Then this call is executed. Is it equal to 1? Then this is executed. If not, and that applies to every stage here, you see the break. It falls through. And if you are in here, you don't want it to have these cases tested. So if you executed this code and you wrote 1 into the console, you break right here, and that means that you leave this switch statement here and you continue here. So this is really everything that's to it here. Okay, you provide a variable that you have to be tested, or that you would test via else if multiple times. And then you just specify the different cases and have different behaviors underneath. So here's no semicolon, or if you've called it like that, but it's just a normal colon here. And this is the behavior specified for the case. If this is executed, you break. If not, you go to this. And then ultimately, you go to this default cause or case. And the default case doesn't have a value here. And it's normally the last one. So if you test it here, I don't know what's the probability of getting like 4 out of 6 zeros, but yes, you can see that was a different number. And you can see that there was no registered behavior. So it wasn't a zero, case 0, it wasn't case 1. So it went to the default and did this behavior and then broke here. And at this point, it doesn't make sense to break, but it's just convention, so you write it all the time. And the break just means that you, after you executed your behavior, you leave the switch statement and don't fall further through. So you fall through, that means that if this isn't the case, then you go on next, and you don't want to, like, if you have a big switch and case chain, like random from 1 to 40, and yes, if you have the first one, like 0, you won't want to like calculate or test every next 39 cases. It's 40, I think. If that makes sense, I hope that I could help you here. And I know again that just having these concepts thrown into the room is very difficult, so I make sure to have some projects after the basic tutorial series just to make it easier to see this, yes, concepts applied. If you have special wishes for that, you could also like send me your ideas on WordPress email. That's no problem. And I hope that I could help you a little bit here. If you want to, you could also have a bigger look at this here. We will learn how this works, especially when we come to OOP, but it's something that you will see all the time once we get there. So maybe you can have some use with the random class and do some experimentation there, but we have a way to go there still. But maybe doing random things in C# is something for you, then you learn something even if you are not interested in switches, I hope so. And yes, I hope to see you soon in the next video, and I wish you everyone, or I wish you all a very good day.